C4 and Bryan Nehman.
WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
Well, the drama was building yesterday, Bryan Nehman, to audiences of what would happen with a vote on what is called the Fiscal Responsibility Act of 2023. Many people might argue with that title. It's a debt limit extension bill. And the vote was 314 to 117. It passed on its way to the Senate. 71 Republicans voted against the bill. Joining us right now is one of those 71. He is the only Republican member of the House from the state of Maryland. Congressman Andy Harris joins us right now. Good morning, Congressman.
Hey, Congressman.
Good morning, C4. Good to be with you.
Thank you so much. And Congressman, let's talk, if we can, about yesterday and your vote. You did tweet out prior to your vote the fact that you did not think that this was a fiscal responsibility act. You're a member of the Appropriations Committee. What do you find wrong with this bill, and why did you and 70 other members of your party vote against it?
Well, look, we're on a collision course with fiscal calamity. There's no question about it. $31.5 trillion federal debt. This bill probably adds another $4 trillion to that federal debt. We can't afford the interest payments now, which are about $600 billion next year. They'll be over $1 trillion in a few years. It's crowding out all our other spending. The only solution is really to just stop the runaway spending over the last few years, and this bill simply, plainly doesn't do that.
Okay, but what was the ultimate goal here, though? Was it not to try and rein in spending, pull it in a little bit? I mean, you did get something out of it, I guess, is what I'm saying. What was, for you, was there a line to negotiate at all, or was it exactly what was passed in the House bill?
No, look, I think that ultimately I agree with what John Boehner said years ago, is if you raise the debt ceiling by a dollar, you should reduce spending by a dollar. And this bill, in contrast, the CBO said it reduced spending by about actually only about $300 or $400 billion in statute. The other $1 trillion in reduced spending is kind of a promise, but not written into law, that we're going to control spending in the future, which, by the way, Congress never does. In return for $4 trillion in debt ceiling increase. I mean, this just keeps us on a path, again, which is going to head to fiscal calamity. There's no question in my mind about it.
So one of the things that Congressman, we're speaking with Maryland Congressman Andy Harris, everyone, Congressman Thomas Massey, who ended up voting this out of the Rules Committee, said that one of the reasons he voted for it himself, being a fiscal hawk, is the fact that there's language in there that would eventually get you back to 12 appropriation bills or regular order in terms of voting on the budget. Is that not how you see it, Congressman, or do you think that that's eventually where we get back to?
Look, I'd love to get back to that. The fact of the matter is, you know, I sit on the Appropriations Committee. My prediction is there's no way we're going to do 12 individual appropriations bills, because there's too much incentive in the bill we passed yesterday to actually not do appropriations bills, to just take the current level of spending in what's called a continuing resolution and just spend at that level. And again, we didn't need to just keep spending level. We actually needed to roll back the spending increases of the past, especially the past couple of years, in order to put us on a path that would lead to, again, avoiding fiscal calamity.
You have a 4-vote majority in the House. The Democrats control the White House and they control the Senate. But what's the political, you know, reality here, right? I mean, the Republicans have very little wiggle room in that aspect. And what political world would you expect more, I guess, is where I'm coming from on that.
Well, look, I agree with you. We only control, you know, one of the three levers of power. I guess the point is that we didn't make an argument strongly enough to the American people that the 2024 election has to be about setting us on a fiscally responsible path once again. And that, again, the fact that as many Democrats as Republicans voted for this bill means that, to the American public, there's not really a distinction between Democrats and Republicans on spending. They kind of agree.
Congressman Andy Harris, another point that was raised in this by at least Speaker Kevin McCarthy is that there's a $1.5 trillion reduction to the debt built into this. It's over 10 years now, but built into this bill. Do you not see that as at least getting half a loaf a little bit?
Look, C4, it's all smoke and mirrors. You know, $1.2 trillion of that amount comes in years 3, 4, 5, and 6, when we set goals for spending, not statutory, not like back in 2011 with the Budget Control Act, where it was set in statute. These are just aspirational goals for spending. And you and I have been in legislatures, you know that those goals just never materialize because the spenders always control everything. So again, it's a smoke and mirrors. CBO assumes that Congress is going to control spending in the future without a statute. That just isn't going to occur.
I guess there would be a lot of people that would be listening to this and say, all right, you know what, I don't disagree with Andy Harris. We need to get better control of spending. But, you know, why would I believe that the Republicans are serious about it when, you know, I realize a lot of it was COVID related for Donald Trump. But even before the pandemic, you were spending more than we were taking in.
Look, I agree with you. Again, the vote yesterday showed there's very little difference between mainstream Republicans and mainstream Democrats on spending.
Well, but that was when Donald Trump was president of the United States, you know, and, you know, you were there in Congress. Where did you vote on that? I don't have the numbers rolled up here. You voted against all the budgets that were put up, or there were no budgets, but continuing resolutions and everything else during the Trump years, the Trump tax cuts.
Yeah, well, let's talk about the Trump tax cuts because they were brought up yesterday. The CBO estimated that those Trump tax cuts would reduce revenues by $2.1 trillion. In fact, they increased revenues. And again, everybody goes back to the old CBO report instead of the fiscal reality that last year we had $900 billion more revenue than before the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act, which means, I don't know, old school math, that tax revenues actually went up with the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act, not went down. I voted for the tax cuts. I voted against the out-of-control spending during the Trump administration as well.
Maryland Congressman Andy Harris, let's talk some politics now. As a result of this vote, you have members of your party, including Congressman Ken Buck from Colorado, who is suggesting next couple of weeks they might want to revisit Kevin McCarthy being Speaker of the House. Are you a part of that discussion in terms of the future of Speaker McCarthy?
I don't think that happens. I think what the vote yesterday shows is that Speaker McCarthy will have enough Democrats back him on a motion to vacate so that it would be a futile effort. I don't think it's going to happen.
Well, I'm asking you in terms of what you think.
Do you think he should go, or do you have confidence in him to continue on as Speaker?
Well, look, I don't usually want to pursue things that are completely futile. So I would suggest that the motion not be made to vacate the chair. Because this isn't the right time. The speaker did the best he could do. I just wish he would message better. He should have come out of this saying, you know what, we really should have gotten a whole lot more spending cuts. This isn't enough. Instead, he trumpeted on the floor yesterday, and a majority of Republicans trumpeted on the floor that this was really a good deal. Well, it really wasn't a good deal for the American people. And the polls clearly show Americans want us to get our fiscal house in order and to pull back some of the wasteful spending that's going on in Washington that's leading to inflation and higher interest rates, which are killing, the American families.
All right, but we all know that the biggest driver of our spending is Social Security and Medicare.
Entitlements.
And where is the Republican Party on it? Because, you know, during the State of the Union speech, Republicans were, you know, kind of clapping for Joe Biden saying, we're not going to touch it. Don't we need to touch Social Security and Medicare if we want to get our fiscal house in order?
This is one of the biggest disappointments, I think, about leadership in Washington right now. You know, everyone knows, just like you said, that those are the biggest drivers of our deficit problems in the future. And no one in leadership wants to deal with it. They don't want to touch the third rail of politics, which is Social Security and Medicare. But it needs to be touched, and leadership needs to do it. Not rank and file members. Leaders like Joe Biden have to come out and say, look, we've done the math. This isn't sustainable. Let's put a bipartisan commission together, just like a BRAC commission on base closings. And whatever comes out of that commission is an up or down vote in the House and the Senate. Strictly bipartisan commission. And we're going to put the recommendations to a vote. Put the politics aside. We have to deal with these issues. Maybe we increase the retirement age. Maybe we increase payroll taxes. But we have to do something. And everyone's just sticking their heads in the ground on this issue, and it's not going to go away.
I'm personally glad to hear you say that, but that's not what is being said by Donald Trump, and it's not what's being said by a lot of people who follow Donald Trump. It seems like this has become the third rail for Republicans to even talk about these things.
Oh, it's a third rail for everyone to talk. I mean, look, you'll probably get callers calling in saying, well, Harris called for cutting Social Security and Medicare on the show. No, we have to deal with the issue. It should be done on a bipartisan basis. Look, leadership in America starts at the top. famously, George Bush, George W. Bush, after he got reelected, wanted to talk about reforming Social Security, and he couldn't do it. Even in a lame duck presidential term, he couldn't do it because there was no other leadership in Washington that was willing to go along with him and address that issue. Had we addressed it at that time, you know, over 10 years ago, we wouldn't be in the situation we're in now.
Well, Congressman Andy Harris, who joins us, Republican from the state of Maryland, once again, one of the no votes, one of the 71 no votes on the debt limit extension. When it came to, speaking of entitlements, the part of the fiscal, the bill that deals with raising the age from 49 to 54 for those who don't have children, are able-bodied, and should be in a work experience or something in order to receive food stamps or whatever. I thought that might be a window, Congressman, into looking at entitlements in a real way, to look at ages and all that stuff. What did you think about that part of the bill?
Well, look, the Congressional Budget Office, because in return for raising that age limit for the waiver of SNAP benefits, in return for that, they expanded the number of people who were exempt from that from the work requirement, and in the end, this deal actually increased the number of people on SNAP benefits, not decreased it, even though a quote work requirement was put into the bill. Look, I think that it's time that we say able-bodied Americans, again, you know, you're not disabled, you're not taking care of children.
And no children, right,
you're
exactly.
You're not elderly. You have a limited time to access federal welfare benefits. Mm-hmm. After that time, you got to get a job. I think the most Americans agree with that. This bill actually went no way far enough in order to do that. And we should include Medicaid on that. We should include, you know, an able-bodied person should be able to go get a job and get off Medicaid as well.
Particularly in this economy where we have so many job openings.
That's right. The news yesterday, 10.1 million job openings probably will result in another interest rate hike. There are plenty of job openings. We have to stop incentivizing people not to work.
Well, last question for me. On the defense side of it, it does allow for more spending on defense, but it looks like it probably will cap it at some point down the road. Are you concerned at all about that aspect of it? And how do you see this impacting the military?
So it will increase defense spending probably around 3% or so, by my best understanding of how things will work out, which, of course, is below the rate of inflation. But I have to tell you, I think at some point it's going to force the Department of Defense to do something it should have done decades ago, which is look at its procurement process. Defense procurement, we buy things, look, the famous, you know, several $100 toilet seats. I mean, we buy things for the Defense Department in an outdated procurement methods. And we have to look at that because I think we could save dozens, maybe even $100 billion if we just modernized our defense procurement. And maybe this will be the thing that finally makes the Department of Defense say, yeah, we actually have to look at that.
Well, Congressman Andy Harris, we always appreciate your time and you can share it with us. Once again, one of the 71 no votes against this, and we'll talk with you in the future.
Good to have you on.
Thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Maryland Congressman Andy Harris on board with us.